Studies show wearing a bicycle helmet prevents 60% of head injury deaths. It also reduces the overall risk of head injuries by 85%. But ever wonder why cycling helmets are shaped the way they are? Or why serious cyclists don't look like this rider, wearing a loose-fitting t-shirt and long pants? Instead, many cyclists wear tight-fitting, racing-type gear. Is it a fashion statement, or is it science? Specifically, motion dynamics. Well, the reality is it's probably both. Riders might want to look good, but the laws of physics require a cyclist to overcome multiple forces to simply put a bike in motion, and aerodynamic clothing helps to do that.
So you're always trying to balance out that, you know, the best aero position and, you know, the most efficient position for putting out power, and kind of trying to match the two to see what the best combination that you can get them is. Okay. Just pedal for a minute, warm up, and we'll calibrate.
David Salazar helps cyclists like Mike Bird ride like the wind by riding the wind in the A2 wind tunnel in Mooresville. The most common misconception of wind tunnels is that air is blown over whatever object or person is being tested. The reality is air is drawn through the wind tunnel because that way the airflow is more uniform. This is the back of the wind tunnel. There are three giant fans just like this, and air can be pulled through the wind tunnel up to 85 miles an hour.
Okay, fans are coming on. So what we do is we want you to just normally do what you normally do racing. Uh-huh. Don't do anything special, and we're gonna get some of the biomechanics measurements down as well as aerodynamic data.
The A2 wind tunnel is the only wind tunnel in the world that combines motion capture technology with high-speed cameras and aerodynamic sensors. That means that biomechanic and aerodynamic data can be captured in real time while the test is happening. So if a cyclist changes positions or headgear or alters anything during a test, the effects can be studied immediately.
It gives me a chance to find out what I can do better. How can I get faster? Does it make a difference if I have an aero helmet versus a road helmet? It quantifies everything. It makes it real. You know, you can read magazines all day long and read about this and that from resistance, but as soon as you get on there and see the numbers changing, it becomes very real.
And here's why all those numbers matter. Cycling is good exercise because the rider has to overcome a lot of forces trying to keep the bike from moving. That's why pedaling is work. Gravity is pulling the bike and the rider down. Drag from air resistance is pushing from the front. There's vertical ground reaction caused by friction between the tire and the ground. And propulsive and rolling resistance caused by braking and inertia, simply getting the bike moving. Make a turn while riding, there's even more force working against the rider. Increase the friction on the wheel, plus torque and centrifugal force. And here's the trouble. The laws of physics dictate that most of those forces can't be changed. Gravity is gravity, can't do anything about that. Different tires and bike designs can reduce the friction with the road, but only a little. Fortunately for cyclists, aerodynamic drag is the largest force a rider has to overcome to get moving. And it's the one force a rider can do something about.
Anywhere from 80 to 90% of the power they're putting out is just to overcome that air resistance. So if we can help them out, you know, 3, 4, 5%, it's huge for them, especially over longer distances, because they're already having to put out so much power. Anytime you can help them, it either helps them get done with the race quicker, or it just helps them, you know, takes less energy to get through the race.
The first thing David notices is that Mike doesn't pedal evenly.
So what we're looking at here is the knee trace. Mm-hmm. Now, since Mike has had surgery on his right knee, we can see it does not track the same as his left knee. Mm-hmm. You can look at these patterns and see this is more curved on the outside, where this is more up and down.
But now look at Mike from this side view. In separate tests, he wore a road helmet and sat in a more upright position. Then he tried an aerodynamic helmet in a tucked position. That lowered his torso by 3 degrees.
You know, obviously we're looking at his angles again, but we can compare this to his baseline position. So this outline I took initially when we ran him, and I can overlay it on this photo so you can see just how much we brought down, you know, not only his head, but his back, the shape of his back has changed. And we brought him down quite a bit, and it definitely helped aerodynamically a lot.
Mike ran 12 positions in 1 hour of testing.
So looking at the baseline to the best, we were able to save him 13.3% drag savings. Now what that equates to, at 28 miles an hour, it would take him 382 watts to maintain that speed in the baseline position, whereas the new position with the aero helmet, now it only takes 337 watts to maintain that position.
A watt is a measure of power. Reducing drag means more efficient pedaling, which means Mike uses fewer watts of power to go just as fast. That saves him energy, which Mike could use in other parts of the race. So, crunch the numbers. That 44 watts of power saved over a 10-mile race would shave 57 seconds off of Mike's race time. Those same aerodynamic principles are used to design everything from bikes and helmets, as we saw at the beginning of the story, to the cars that cyclists ride by, to the planes that fly up above, all in an effort to save energy.
That's big time. That saves a lot of energy for either if you're a triathlete especially. You know, you're going to be able to run a lot faster and a lot further, saving that 40 watts during the race.